Good morning, dear students. Welcome to another session of Introduction to Data Structures and Algorithms. So in the previous session, we were discussing regarding queues. So in which we were discussing regarding circular queue and the operations, what are performed on those. So these are the steps what we have to look out when we are dealing with insert operation and the delete operation. So this actually gives you the possible conditions with respect to the circular queue. So this is what these two statements are providing. So now continuing, so yesterday's discussion, what we had. So in yesterday's session, we were discussing regarding the algorithm for insert operation in the array implementation of the circular queue. So here, so when we start off, what we have is the first thing what we are checking is we are checking whether front is equal to 0 and rear is equal to max minus 1. So this is basically telling that if you have a queue, say if the queue can hold around 5 elements. So you can hold around 5 elements, which is your maximum value. So if max is equal to 5, then the indexes, if you just check, it will be 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So this is max minus 1. So now in this case, what we are doing is we are checking whether the front pointer is pointing to the element at index 0. And the condition, the logical, this thing is and. So and rear pointer. And a rear pointer is pointing to the element which is indexed, say, max minus 1. So in this case, it is 5 minus 1, that is 4. So if this condition is true, then what happens is you will be going to step 3. Now, since there is an OR operation, either this condition has to be true or this condition has to be true. So if any one of the condition or both the conditions are true, then the execution will, or then step 3 will be executed. And the message will be displayed that queue is full. So the first one, if I just check, in this case, if this entire condition has to be true, these to both the conditions should be true together. If any one of the condition fails, right, then it will be false. It will be false. So here, here we have the major catch what we have to look out when we're implementing from the logical point of view. So first thing is you're checking whether front is pointing to 0, that is the 0th index element, and rear is pointing to the last element, that is max minus 1. So that is what we had displayed over here. So if there are 5 elements, front is pointing here and rear is pointing to this element. So if you just observe, if both the conditions are true, it indicates that queue is full. So if this condition is true, then queue is full will be displayed. It gives an indication that queue is full. Now in this case, either front is not equal to 0, if front is not equal to 0, that is this condition fails, or rear is not equal to max minus 1. What does this indicate? For example, if I just consider, so in the previous case, we saw that if front is equal to 0 and rear is equal to 0. So we observed that thing when these two conditions are true. Now, for this condition to be false, either of these two statements should be false, or both the statements can be false. So now what we can do is, if I just consider, now there is a possibility that when you delete the element, this front pointer goes and points to the next element. Say, let me assume that it is in this form. So if you have deleted, this goes off. So in this case, what I'll be having? I'll be having front is equal to 1. Say, let me consider rear is pointing at 4, at the index location 4. So if this is the case, then what happens is this condition fails over here. Because in this, if front is not equal to 0, so the condition was, So here front is equal to zero was the condition, but if you have deleted, what happens is the front pointer goes and points to the next element, which is present after the element that has been deleted. So therefore, if this condition fails, but this is true, then what happens is overall condition of this one will be false. This one will be false. So therefore, to go to step three, what is the alternate check we have to do? We have to check whether front is equal to rear plus one. Now, another major catch of circular queue is circular queue in this case is having a limited size. Circular queue is having a limited size. So here we had seen, right? So another possibility is when if you just check, this is a circular queue, and once all the elements are filled and none of the elements are being deleted, so front pointer will be pointing here and a rear pointer will be pointing here. So now if you just add one to this, it will be equal to the front pointer. So what is this telling? This is also giving us indication that if this condition is true, if this condition is true, then the queue is full. So if this is false, I can just have a cross verification even with this. So both the conditions are helping me to identify whether the queue is full or not. So if this condition is true, then what happens is it goes and displays that queue is full. So now what is important for us is, we need to identify what happens if this fails or what happens if this fails. Because if these two fail and if this condition is totally false, that is rear is not front is not equal to rear, which is the case what we can observe over here. So this condition is failing. So this is false. This is false. So if this is false, then step three won't be executed if this condition is overall false. So now for that to happen, either this condition should be false or this condition should be false. So these are the two possibilities what we have to look out for. So now first thing what we can do is, now if front is pointing to index element one, so in that case, this condition fails. In that case, this condition fails. So in this case, if you can just observe that rear is equal to max minus one, say I'll just considering this case. So here you can see that rear is equal to max minus one. This condition is true, but this is false. Since there is a logical operation, false and true will lead to a condition of false. So if both these are false, then it gives us an indication that Q is not full. Q is not full. So therefore, what we should do is we should go to step four. We should go to step four. So in step four, what we are doing is the first thing what we have to do is we have to check whether front is equal to null, because even that is possible when you are checking for front equal to zero. Now, if the queue is empty, first and the rear pointers are initialized to null. So if you're checking with front is equal to zero, and if there is a value of null, then the statement is still false. Statement is still false. So here what you're doing is, if this these statements are not executed, that is this condition fails and step three is not executed, giving us an indication that Q is not full. So now what you have to do is you have to check whether front is equal to null. So this is what you're doing here is you're checking whether the queue is empty. You're checking whether the queue is empty. If the queue is empty, you go to step five. So in step five, what you're doing is front and the rear pointer, you are updating with zero. So since the element what you will be adding, if this condition is true, queue is empty, therefore the element what you will be inserting will be the first element present in the queue. And first element is identified by the index associated with, or the pointer associated with front and rear pointers. So since it is the first element, front and rear pointers will be updated with zero. will be updated with 0. So once these two things are done, you go and insert the element. Now, next thing, if this is also false, that is, if front is not equal to null, if front is not equal to null, then it indicates that at least one element may be present in the queue. And since this statement, if you just check over here, if this was false, then only you came to step 4. So indicating that there is some space available in the queue and you can use that space to insert the element. So now for that case, so first thing you check whether queue is empty, then you can insert the element. Now if queue is not empty, then what you're doing is you're going to step 6. Now, here if you just check, if rare is equal to max minus 1, then you need to go to step 7. Now, here in order to understand this condition, right, we need to check this case now again. So in this case, what had happened if I considered this condition, right? Rare is equal to max minus 1. And front, if you just observe, in this case, it is 1. So this condition failed, but this is still satisfied. Therefore, overall condition was false. And this condition was also false. Since both the conditions were false, you got an indication that Q is not full. Now you check for the Q, whether it is empty. But that condition failed, so you come to step 6. Now in step 6, what you're doing is you're just cross-verifying whether rare is pointing to the last location. So in this case, if I consider, right, that is condition what I am having. So this state what I am having. So if I check over here, what happens is this will be false only if front is not equal to 0. So only this is the possibility which can be false over here. So rare is pointing at max minus 1, front is pointing at 1. And if you just check, front is equal to rare plus 1 is also false. So therefore, only possibility now what we need to look out is front is not equal to 0. So that is what we can observe here. Front is pointing to 1. So here at least one location is available wherein I can insert the element. So here if rare is equal to max minus 1, what you're doing is you need to go to step 7. In step 7, what you're doing, you are updating the rare pointer to 0. So here you can observe that it is 5 minus 1, that is max minus 1, wherein the rare this thing is pointing. But I got to know that Q is having some space. So where is that space available? That is available at index 0. So therefore, what we did, we updated the rare pointer with 0. And after this, actually, we should go and insert the element in that location. So that one, this thing, you can just add over here. Now, step 8 is actually related to the else part of this statement. So when does this come? So I'll consider this only. Front is pointing to 1 and rare is pointing to location 3. So only these three locations are having the element. So there are, I'll write it as 2. So these are empty spaces. So now if you just make an observation. So in this case, what happens is front is not equal to 0. So this is also false. And if I just consider rare is pointing at this one. So this condition is also false. So if this condition is false, so if I just check over here, rare, you're again checking with max minus 1. So this condition will be false and step 7 will not be executed. So now what does it this indicate? This indicates that you haven't reached the end of this array. You haven't reached the end of the array. So still you have some locations left. It may be just one location or more than one location. So if I just increment this index by one, I'll be pointing to the next free location. So that is what you're doing. If rare is not equal to max minus one, you need to go to step eight. So in step eight, what you're doing, you are going ahead with rare is equal to rare plus one. So by doing this, you are pointing to the next immediate location or the index which is available in the array. And at that location, what you're doing is you are going and storing the element. So this is the logic which is associated with inserting an element into an array. So now here, just one thing to read out is this part. Step seven is actually associated with true condition. Step seven is associated with true condition. Now, if this condition fails, what you're doing is you are going to step eight. You're going to step eight. So here you can see there was another algorithm which I had just checked out on the net. So here, the same thing they have done. Don't worry about the numbers. It is just the index values what they are referring to. So now it is same. So there what we had, we are checking front is equal to zero and it is rare is equal to max minus one. So instead of zero, they have taken the first value as with the index of one. So that is what they have done over here. So no need to worry about this. So the same check. You're checking whether front is equal to one, that is in our case it is zero, and rare is equal to max minus one. So if these two conditions are true, then you print that it is an overflow, that is queue is full. Or if this condition is true, then also you print that the queue is full. Else what you have to do is, so this f is this if is having this else part. So in else what you have to do is you're checking whether rare is equal to zero. So in that case, what we are doing, we are checking whether rare is equal to max minus one. So that is, if rare is equal to zero, you're checking whether the queue is empty. So in this case, we are checking that front is equal to null. Whether front is equal to null. If front is equal to null, then there are no elements present. So that is queue is empty. So in that case, what we had done, we had updated front and rear pointers to index zero, that is using, considering the indexing is from zero. So, but in this case, what we are doing is in this algorithm, we are considering one as the starting index. So you are updating one for both. Now, what we can see is for this F, if we have this else, so if this fails, then this condition gets executed. Now in this condition, what you're doing is you're checking whether you are reached at the end of the queue. You have reached end of the queue. So if you reach end of the queue, you are setting rare is equal to one. So that is here, it is this part. If rare is equal to max minus one, then you set rare is equal to zero. That is you set it at the first, that is the first element. You set it at the first element. Or else what you're doing is you are setting it over here. So once you set this, what you're doing is you come out of the if statement. So if you just observe this part, right, here you're checking whether rare is equal to n, which is nothing but max minus one. So if that is the case, you make rare is equal to one in this case. In this thing, it is rare is equal to zero. And after this, what you're doing is you have to go and execute this statement where Q of rare is equal to item. So here, just add one statement in this case. So that is once you update this, right, then what you do is once you perform that, you add go to step nine. Otherwise, what happens is you will be continuing with the statements and this will be confusing. This will be confusing. So you set the rare pointer is equal to zero and go to step nine. So in step nine, you are updating the queue or inserting the element at the end of the queue. Now, if this is false, you're going to step A and you are incrementing the rear pointer and inserting the element. So that is the logic which is associated with the insertion of the Q element. So next one, we'll see the algorithm which is relevant to the delete operation in array implementation of the Q. So here we have the name of the algorithm as delete, and the parameters what we'll be utilizing in this will be the Q and the maximum size of the Q, then the front and the rear pointers. Now we'll be deleting the elements from the rear end. So here once we start off, the first thing what we check is front is equal to null. So if this is true, it gives an indication that Q is empty. So that is what you are performing in step 3. Now, if Q is not empty, then you need to go and perform the step 4. So in step 4, what you are doing is you are retrieving the element which is present at the starting of the Q, that is, which is identified by the front pointer. So you take that element, you store it in another variable, say, or parameters, which is named as I. So you have retrieved the element which is at the first, which is pointed by the front pointer, which is nothing but the first element in the queue. So once you have retrieved this, there are a few checks what you have to look out for. You're checking whether front is equal to rear. So when does this condition come into existence? It comes into existence when there is only one element present in the queue. So for example, if I just consider, so there are this thing, and what happens is there is one element X present over here. So if that is the case, what happens is front pointer will be pointing to this index and rear pointer will also be pointing to this index. Now you have retrieved the element. Now if both front and rear pointers are pointing to the same index, that is the same element in the array implementation of the queue, it gives us an indication, that is, if front is equal to rear, it gives us an indication that there is only one element present in the queue. So therefore, when you delete this, when you remove or retrieve this element, right? When you retrieve this element, you need to give an indication that the queue is empty. So how do you update this information? You update this information by updating the front and the rear pointers to null values. So if this condition is true, it gives us an indication that there is only one element present in the queue. So once you retrieve or delete the element from the queue, you update the front and the rear pointers with the null pointer and you stop the process of deletion. So in this case, in step 7, what you're doing is you are returning the element which is being deleted from the queue, and you're going to step 13, wherein you are stopping the entire process of deletion. Now, suppose if front is not equal to rear, so then what does this indicate? It indicates that there is more than one element present in the queue. It gives us an indication that there is more than one element present in the queue. So if this condition fails, that is what we have. So if that is the case, we need to go and execute step 8. So in step 8, what we are doing is, first thing what we are checking is whether front is equal to max minus 1. So in insert operation, you observed what was happening. So that is, we had 5 elements. So index 0. Say front pointer is pointing to here, which gives us an indication that at index 1, I am having the first element. And here, I am having the last element. So rear pointer is pointing over here. So when new element has to be inserted, we get to know that this space is free. So therefore, what you do is you update the rear pointer and insert the element over here. So now in this process, what happens is if you're deleting the elements, so it will be like the elements which are pointed by the null pointer will be deleted. So now here, what you're checking is whether front is equal to max minus 1. So whether the front pointer has reached the last location of the queue. That is the last location of the queue. If that is true, then what you need to do is you need to go to step 7. So in step 7, what happens is if you have reached over here, once you delete this element, you have to go and point, you have to go and update the front pointer to point to the zeroth index. Go and point to the zeroth index. Now this is possible because on top you have checked whether front is equal to rear, this is false. Whether front is equal to null, this is false. Okay, so that is what you are checking over here. So in that that case, so even if only one element remains at that position, what happens is in this case front is equal to rear. So that condition will come over here. So now you are deleted the elements. All these elements are deleted. Front pointer is pointing to last element, so which is max minus 1. That is what you have. Now, if this is the case and you're deleting this element, right, which is identified by the index max minus 1, then what you have to do is you retrieve this element. You retrieve this element and update the front pointer to point to index 0. Index 0. So once you do that, you stop the process of deletion. You retrieve the element and send it to the user, indicating that this element has been deleted, and stop the process of deletion. Now, if this condition is false, so if this is false, then if I just consider, if this is false, then it might be pointing at some other location. It might be pointing at some other location. It indicates that I have to just increment the pointer and point it to the next location. If this condition is false, then it indicates that front pointer is having value which is less than max minus 1. That is, in our case, it is having a value which is less than 4. Which is less than 4. So if that is the case, then what we do is we just go and increment the pointer and update the front pointer, giving an indication that this element is deleted and the element at the next location becomes the first element of the queue. So this is what we are doing in delete operation. You retrieve the element, send it back, and stop the delete operation. So that is what you are doing in circular queue. So we have the algorithm which is pertaining to implementation of circular queue using the array implementation. So I'll come back to this part a little bit later. So I'll just go ahead with the next part and discuss few more concepts. So next one, what we have is the priority queue. So now here one additional thing, it is same as your queues, what you have discussed previously. Say I'll be considering the first one wherein you are inserting the, and you are not performing the circular queue, but you are using your regular queue. So in this one additional thing which comes is you will be having some priorities which are assigned to the elements. And based on that priority, your delete operation will be performed. So deletion of an element from the queue will be depending on the priority. So that is what priority queue will be. Now, what are the rules for deletion of the element in a priority queue? So again, as I specified, you'll be having priorities which are given for the elements, and based on the priority, the deletion of the elements happens. Now, whenever you want to perform a delete operation, right, the element with the highest priority will be deleted first. Element with the highest priority will be deleted first. And then the lower priority elements will be followed. Now, there comes a situation, what if two elements have same priority? Two elements have same priority. So in that case, what rule you follow is you follow the rule of first in, first out. So in this case, what you're doing is, now if I am having say I'm having these elements, and highest priority is given to this element and this element, and these are given some different priorities. So if these are two elements which are having the same priority, so these are the elements and this is the priority, then what is done is when you perform the delete operation, the element which was inserted first into the queue will be deleted. Now, because highest priority element has to be deleted first. So in that case, what happens is here there is an ambiguity. So in that case, one was the element which was inserted first. So this element gets deleted. So this is the rules for delete operation in a priority queue. And when you observe the structure which is associated with the queue, that is, which is nothing but an abstract data type, what we are defining for the queue. In that, you have the element or the info field, what we had discussed, and you had a pointer member. So this is a member which is termed as element, and this is a member which is termed as next. So which is basically a pointer to this data type, struct queue data type. One additional thing what we have to insert is we have to insert the priority member also. So which will be utilized when you are performing the delete operation and when you're when you're inserting the element, you need to check for what is the priority. You can assign the priority over there and store that information. So once you store this information, using this, you will be performing the delete operations. So this is what you're doing in priority queue. So this is implementation of priority queue in which one additional parameter or member which is coming in is nothing but the priority. So in this case, slight change where you can observe is in the delete operation. So if you just check here, we have delete operation, right? So in that delete operation, you need to check out for the priority when you're deleting it. Okay. Here you have delete. So while inserting itself, you are storing the elements in a proper form. So that is what you are doing, which will make the delete operation much simpler over here. So therefore, you can see that this logic what they have implemented, it is almost same as the one what we have done previously. So you are storing the in while storing only, you are taking care of those things. So in program, you are looking forward for that aspect. So based on the priority, you are trying to adjust the few things and you are storing those information over there. So we'll come back to that. So next one, what we have is a double-ended queue, which is also termed as DQ. Now, what is meant by double-ended queue? So in previous queue discussion, you observed that you can insert element from the front end and delete element from the rear end. Now, if a queue permits to insert and delete elements from both the ends, that is from the front end and the rear end. So such kind of queue is termed as DQ or double-ended queue. Now, one thing to note down is I cannot insert or delete an element from the middle of the queue in a DQ. So this is what DQ will be. And what are the different types of DQs we can have based on different conditions associated with insertion and deletion of the elements? Now, first one is input restricted DQ. So in this one, what happens is since input is restricted, input in the sense insertion will be restricted. So in this case, what does this imply? It implies that insertion will be permitted from only one end of the queue. It will not be permitted at both the ends. So therefore, you are restricting the insertion of the elements into the DQ. But deletion is permitted in both the ends. Deletion is permitted from front end or the rear end. Now, next one, what we have is output restricted DQ. So you are restricting how you are deleting. That is, what is this statement specifies? You are restricting how you are deleting the element, what is the permission you are providing. So you are restricting the deletion operation on the DQ from only one direction. In only one direction, you are permitted to delete an element. But you are permitted to insert the element from both the ends of the queue, that is the DQ. So these are the two types of what we have. So this is, you can see the logical implementation. You have a front end, rear end, as we have the queue. So this is the entire queue. So in DQ, we can perform insertion and deletion from the front end, and we can perform insertion and deletion from the rear end. Now, based on the restrictions what you are putting, you will be having input restricted DQ and output restricted DQ. Now, what are the possible operations you can see when you are using these different kinds of DQs, what you observe? So first one, what we have is I front. That is, in this case, insertion is permitted at the end, at the front end of the queue. Then we have defriend, wherein deletion from the front end of the queue is permitted. Then we have irear, where insertion is permitted from the rear end. And we have drear, where deletion is permitted from the end of the queue. So this is again associated with the input or the output restricted DQs. So based on that, you have ifront, defriend, irear, and drear. So in so this is the case what we have. These are the operations what we can perform on the DQ. So these are functions which give us the indication associated with ifront and defriend, irear, and drear. So this is all what we have for today. Let us meet in the next session. In next session, I'll discuss regarding the programs what we have left out here. So regarding these two, I'll be just discussing these programs. And then I'll be discussing regarding the other aspects. Okay. So thank you.